got a big crowd, so I have to use my outdoor voice. We're going to open the, what's the date today? The April 12th school committee meeting. If you could all stand and we'll pledge allegiance, please. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Start to our meeting. Tristan, for the record, let the minutes show that all members are present. Thank you. The first item on our agenda is our consent agenda. We've got a pretty long list, so I'm going to try to make it go as fast as possible. The first item is our approval of minutes from March 22nd regular session. I believe that all of us can vote on that. Could I ask for a motion to approve those? Mrs. Kane, seconded by Mrs. Bonish. The next item is the approval of the WEF Awards. These are our tribute to Joanne Benton. We call it the Joanne Benton Grant for Educators Exploration for the amount of $3,000. This is through the Wilmington Educational Foundation, and we have two award winners this year in the amount of $1,500 each. We have Wilmington High School English teacher John Lewis and Shawsheen art teacher Kathleen McNamara. So that's great, and we really appreciate the efforts of WEF on the behalf of our educators. So thank you. Could I have a motion to approve those grants, please?
So moved.
So Mr. Talbot first, second. Mrs. Burns, all in favor? Thank you. Alrighty, the next item, we have an out-of-state field trip from DECA. This is for an international career development conference out in California. I think it's the home of the mouse in California, Anaheim, I see. For April, and that's April 26th through the 30th, so next week. Could I have a motion to approve that, please? Mrs. Kane, thank you for a second. Mrs. Burns, all those in favor? That would be unanimous, thank you. The next item is another out-of-state field trip. This is for the high school strings program, grades 9th through 12th, and it's a trip to perform at Disney in Florida in November, the beginning of November. Any questions or comments on that one? Mrs. Burns.
I had some questions regarding the number of chaperones. I would like to table this piece till our next meeting to gather just some additional minor details to it. There are about 70 students who are expecting to attend. I just would like to know what the student to teacher ratio would be for this trip, as well as if it's parents and staff, what the makeup of those chaperones would be with regards to it.
Okay, I had the same question actually. And I was also curious, Mr. Talbot?
It says max students 20.
I'm looking at Disney.
Oh, I thought we were in Nicaragua.
Not yet.
Not yet, soon. We're still domestic. Looks like about 70. Any other questions on the Strings Trip to Disney in next November?
Hi, I'm Ms. Perkins. I'm here to answer any questions.
Great, Ms. Perkins. Thank you for joining us.
No problem. Thank you for having me. Right now, I'd be myself as a faculty member, and I'm looking to take one other faculty member, and the rest of the chaperones would be made up of parent volunteers that would go on the trip with us, looking to keep the ratio at about 8 students to 1 chaperone.
Can I ask you, do you think that that's a, and this is just a no intent, do you think that with regards to visiting the resorts, that that would be a safe number?
I do. And it is the same ratio that Barb Meddy does when she does her band trips. This is the same company and the same trip that she does.
Okay, I just want to make sure, because I did my first trip to Disney, and I'm like, that's all I can do to take care of two, never mind.
No, it's okay. And with the middle school students, we take those students on a ratio of 1 to 6, but for high school, 1 to 8 seems to be about the a good rate.
I had a question. I know in the past, there was some concerns from the Strings parent group, and I just want to make sure that we have their buy-in on this trip as well.
We do.
Okay,
we
that's
do.
Good
They're
to
very
hear.
Much in support of this and it being a school trip as well.
And it being a school trip. Okay,
yes.
Thank you for the clarification.
Thank you very much.
No problem.
Any other questions? Mrs. Burns, does that
I'm good.
Answer?
Okay. Yes, thank you.
All right, then I will ask for a motion to approve the Wilmington High School Strings Orlando Disney World trip. Mr. Mulis, thank you. Second, Mrs. Burns. All those in favor? That would be unanimous. You're welcome. Okay, now we can move on to our field trip to Costa Rica and Nicaragua. And this one is also for high school students. It looks like it would be around the April vacation timeframe of next year, 2018. Is there any questions or comments on that one? Mrs. Burns.
I have to say, I love the aspect of giving back to a community that may not be as fortunate as our own. I love that piece of this trip, going to orphanages and just having our students experience what that's like. I'm not saying it's destitute. I'm not sure. I'm sure that's it's not in those dramatic realms, but I have to just comment that I love that aspect of this trip. And I would ideally love to have students come back after they go, you know, do this trip to just give us their insight as to their experiences and what they've come away with from traveling. I think it would be beneficial for future trips as well. And I'd be just intrigued to listen to know what that looks like for them.
Any other questions or comments on the Costa Rica Nicaragua field trip? All right, then I think we can ask for a motion to approve, please. Mr. Bjork first, is there a second? Mr. Talbot, thank you. All those in favor? That looks like that's unanimous. Thank you. Okay, we also have the approval of the GE Star grant to Mrs. Maura Tucker. And this is the Institute of International Education on behalf of the GE Foundation awarded student Ms. Jessica Nussbaum the 2016 GE Star Award. In addition to the one-time financial award granted to Ms. Nussbaum, the GE Star Awards, a GE Foundation grant program with a one-time financial award of $500 to the student's high school. Ms. Nussbaum nominated Mrs. Tucker, our social studies teacher, to receive this award to be used for Wilmington High School at Ms. Tucker's discretion. Any questions or comments on that one? No? Okay, so we, as per our policy, we need to approve. I'll ask for a motion to approve the GE Star Awards, please. Mrs. Bonish first. Second, Mrs. Kane, thank you. All those in favor? Looks like unanimous to me. Thank you very much. Okay, now we've got a bunch of warrants here. We have warrants G412, 413, 414, 415, R217, 218, 219, L30, 31, 32, 33, FS24, 25. I believe all of us can vote on that. Could I have a motion to approve that group, please? Mrs. Kane first, second. Thank you. Mr. Bjork second. All those in favor? That would be unanimous. Thank you. We've got a payroll warrant for weekend March 29th. Could I have a motion to approve? Mr. Mulis, thank you. Mr. Bjork, second. All those in favor? One abstention. I'm going to jump down to warrant CFO4, please. I believe all of us can vote on that. Could I have a motion to approve warrant CFO4? Ms. Burns, second. Mr. Bjork, thank you. All those in favor? That would be unanimous. Thank you. All right, and then the next two all grouped together. We have warrant CB09, CB10, SPED 20, 21, and 22. Could I have a motion to approve that group, please? Mrs. Bonish, please, seconded. Mrs. Kane, thank you. All those in favor? With two abstentions, thank you. Great, I think we got it. All right, the next item on our agenda is our student representative report.
Good evening.
Hi.
Hello. So Wilmington High has been as busy as ever since the last time I saw you. We are officially into quarter four now. Today we had the freshman history fair from 6 to 7 p.m. I hope it went well. I saw a lot of the projects. They were all set up in the library, and the freshmen did a fantastic job on them. Tomorrow, the field trip to Ireland, Scotland, and England begins, which is very exciting. I'm going on it myself, so thanks for approving it. On March 28th, we had a substance abuse presentation for the juniors and seniors by Mrs. Karen Sullivan, who shared her very powerful message with us all. I think it was pretty impactful, and the students took a lot away from it. The academic support evening program has started back up. Students can drop in for help with homework as well as preparation for exams with the teachers from 5 to 8 p.m. MCAS preparations will also begin and be available for students from March 29th to April 12th and April 26th to May 10th from 5:30 to 7 p.m. for sophomores. Junior prom took place April 7th at the Tewksbury Country Club, and I heard that they had a fantastic time. That looks like I have everything for you, and tonight looks like fun.
Great. Thank you very much for your report, and safe travels. Have fun. It's
going to
be a great trip for you.
Great.
All right. We do not have anything under superintendent's report this evening, so we are moving on to old business, and we do have an update under superintendent's search. And as was previously announced through multiple means, the school committee unanimously voted to appoint Mr. Paul Ruggiero as our interim superintendent. We are confident in his ability to lead us through our latest transition, and we are extremely fortunate to have a talented and caring team of individuals that will help guide our district through the latest transition. I think it's important to point out that this does not mean that we are restarting our search activities immediately for the next superintendent. The school committee will meet again in the future to discuss the next steps relating to this search. I'd also like to thank our school committee candidates for sharing what you would like to see in our next superintendent. Even if you're not elected, I expect that you will continue to keep us informed of your opinions on the matter. So thank you. And moving on to new business, we're going to take things out of order a little bit. As a school committee member, particularly after some of the challenges we face this year, it can be really easy for us to get bogged down in the business of running a school district. And as I reflected as chair, we haven't had a very fun year, have we? So I thought we could use a reminder of why we do this anyway. So Ms. Peters was gracious enough to help me coordinate some presentations from our kids. And as you can tell, we've got a huge audience tonight. So we're gonna have some students present to us and share some of the great things that they've been working on this year. I'm also gonna say a special thank you to Mary Palin, our Director of Food Services, and her team for providing the treats in the hallway. And her brownies are fabulous, if you haven't had one yet. So with that, I'm gonna ask our students, as you present, we're gonna put you on the hot seat just a little bit, okay? But this is so we can all hear you and you can also be on camera, but we won't throw anything at you. So our first presentation is from the Intergenerational Project.
That is us.
That is you, great.
sitting, right?
Yeah. Pretty sure.
Is it this one?
Yeah, that's the one.
Yeah, that's it.
Thank you. All right, so this is a presentation on my English class with seniors from Ms. Desberg, and we went over to the senior center over there, and Joe's just gonna tell you a little bit what we did.
All right, my name is Joe Gaudreau, and I'm in Ms. Desberg's English class, obviously. And what we did is our English class, we went to the senior center across the street to interact and connect with the senior citizens of the town, just get to know them better, know their story. For an ice, like we had an icebreaker, like a bingo thing. I don't know, best way to describe it. And we had lunch with them, and we just like talked, and we each connected with a single senior citizen, and asked some questions that we prepared for that visit. In this picture, there's me. I'm in the sling. After my senior citizen that I met, Dick Wetzler, I love this guy. But I made a PowerPoint with the information that he gave me about his life, and we presented it at the senior center at the next visit that we had. And it was really awesome. We all liked it. And some other presentations that other kids did were scrapbooks and poems, and it was really nice.
Yeah, that's me. All right. So I'm Matt Coleman, and so this like really affected us in a pretty big way because we don't really get to go out and talk to senior citizens that much because, well, the senior citizens, and we're 18, and we have a different lifestyle than them. But it was still good that we could go over there and interact with them because they don't get to talk to many people like us. And just because they old, just because they are old doesn't mean that they're boring. A lot of them had a lot of really interesting stories, and they were, and they actually remembered them, too. They had a really good, they had a really good memory. So, and we were amazed by that. And some of us were inspired from what the seniors told us. One of them, I want to be a journalist when I grow up. So he told me to go down to WCTV and that I could go on their crew call and do some stories for them. So I just recently just got in contact with them, and I followed through with that. And they're allowing me to go out, and they gave me a camera, and they're allowing me to go out and do all that. And I was inspired because of the man that I talked to told me to go do that, so I went and did it. And a lot of other people were told other things, and they also gave us some life tips on succeeding, simply just living our lives. They told us, don't get mad over the small things, like go out and do everything you can to make yourself successful. And the overall experience just made us feel good inside because we were able to talk to these people, and they were so happy that we even like talked to them. They were amazed that we were able to go over there because a lot of kids our age don't do that. So, like I said, a lot of people don't go out of their way to have a conversation with somebody who is 60 years older than them and has a hard time hearing. And the fact that we did this made us all feel like we were making a difference. Oh, that's Brenna.
I'm Brenna Buckley, and participating in this field trip was different from a normal school lesson because it was very interactive and truly a hands-on experience. Rather than communicating with our peers, we were given the opportunity to hear several perspectives on life from a different generation. The purpose behind this was to create real-life connections that we could look back on and relate to as we head towards our future as young adults. In addition to that, as a student whose grandparents live out of state, this field trip granted me the chance to gain wisdom from an older and more experienced individual.
So the significance for the project, well, I'm Matthew Abbott, and the senior trip was very beneficial to both of our class and the seniors. Ms. Peters shared with us that her father is 92 years old and doesn't get many opportunities to get out, except for on the weekends he does races. And same with these seniors, they're so happy when they saw us and were able to interact with us. In your life, we tend to fall into routines, and it helped us and them break that schedule. This interaction had more of an impact than another school project. With this, we have made connections and learned new social skills that will help us make connections when we go off to college next year.
So I'm Emily Eckert. So because we had such a good time, like
interacting with the seniors. Ms. Peters gave us permission to invite them to our graduation. So it says, to our seniors, from the bottom of our hearts, we are forever grateful for the laughter, the fun, and the memories. We are so thankful. The moments we shared are some of the most cherished of our high school education. So we would be honored if you were able to be part of our graduation from your seniors at the WHS.
That's great. Thank you very much.
This is us before we went in. We're all pretty nervous, but we're just posing, being silly. And then here's some pictures of us presenting with our senior in our presentations, and we were able to get it on TV. And behind us is all the other seniors and students listening and watching. And then this is all of us at the end with the seniors in my English class. So thank you, Ms. Desberg, for letting us do that. It was a great opportunity.
Comment. Okay, at first I wasn't going to say this, but it got better towards the end on the senior part. I happen to go there for exercises 3 times a week, and when I tell you, and Ms. Desberg, I can't even tell you what you have done for those the seniors up there. They are constantly talking about you and your visit and how wonderful you were, and that people want to know about what their life was like. And they were so grateful. Everything you said is so true, and they're still talking about it, and I can't imagine what they're gonna say about the invitation. So you did a wonderful job, and these are the people who started our community. A lot of the people, well, that's my exercise class. I know this one, oh my goodness. but you know what, it's okay. Once you're a senior, or a mini senior, I like to think of myself as, then you can do these things and know that they're so meaningful. It was so meaningful what you have done. Well, thank you so much. And thank you for your teacher, because the teachers don't, this is all volunteer, and the work that she has placed in this and helped you. I can't even say, it's so wonderful. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Great. Thank you again. Right. Our next group to present is Media Productions. That would be you guys. All right.
Hi.
Hi.
The first group who are going to go is me. I'm Zoe Marzi. This is Anna Pietropaolo, and this is Trevor Breen. We're going to be showing you the first project that we actually made in our Media Productions class. It only seemed fitting that the theme for it was Wildcat Pride, and so the setting of our video is Wilmington High School.
Now, we started off with a really simple idea, but as it got fleshed out and we started thinking of fine details, we got a little bit carried away, but I believe that any creative project, getting carried away is the best thing you can do, because you get so passionate about it, and you just put a lot more effort into it than you normally.
We had a ton of fun filming this. We actually asked some of Trevor's friends to help film us for extra actors, and so it was a lot of fun showing them around the school. They were like blown away with how nice the facilities were. Since we got so carried away, we sort of had the wiggle room to sort of focus on some of our personal like expertise. So Anna did all of the makeup you're gonna see, and Trevor actually wrote the music in the final scene. So we had a ton of fun filming this, and we hope you enjoy.
Thank you.
So the audio isn't blasting.
Oh yeah. Sorry if the audio is blasting right now.
Oh,
we haven't looked at it.
Oh, right. Turn it down. Oh, that's not too bad.
Thank you. prepare to die.
It's right up next. Look at that.
Hello.
My name is J.R. McGowan. My other group member couldn't be here today, so I guess I'm alone. I'm quite nervous.
It's all right.
So their videos were more creative and just a lot more fun. And I don't have that skill. I've tried, but I'm not quite there. Instead, me and my partners decided to take the analytical route. Focus on the skills and techniques that our teacher, Mr. Noble, wherever he is, he taught us a lot, and we used a lot of it to make a mock trailer. As you can see, it's Scott Pilgrim. The movie came out like 2010, and we just really loved it, so here we go.
Situation. I skimmed it.
presentations. Anybody have comments?
Yeah, they were very good.
Really good.
They were great. Thank you.
Thanks.
All right, up next, Decca. Come on down. We just approved your trip.
First, I would just like to start off with a little bit about myself. My name is Joseph Wilson. I'm a sophomore here at Wilmington High School. This is my second year in DECA, and this year I am the class president. I am also on the leadership board for DECA. My role on that board is on the competition preparation, which our role is to help the new members and returning members really feel confident for their competitions. We set up mock role plays and mock test situations so that way they can really see and experience what our competitions are going to be like. So DECA is an international association of high school students, and it prepares them to be emerging leaders in the real world. It puts them in situations where they have to think on their feet and critical business applications. Although it is much more than that. DECA is one of the only clubs that integrates 21st century skills such as public speaking and presentation style. At our competitions, the judges look for that. They look for how we speak, they look for how we present ourselves, and they analyze our ideas. So not only do you have to speak, you have to be creative, and you have to really think outside the box for some of this stuff. Role plays, it can be anything from you're applying for a position as a tour guide on a cruise ship, or you're applying for a position at a hotel, and they give you scenarios as to where maybe a customer isn't happy with the service, and you have to figure out how to sort of diffuse the situation and please the customer while also doing what's in the best interest for the hotel or the establishment. The types of competitions in the United States that DECA competes in is districts. This year they took place in December in Boxborough. At districts we had about 110 students attend. In March we had SCDC, which is the State Career Development Conference, and we had about 45 students attend that one. And later on this month, which we approved earlier in the meeting, is the ICDC, which is the International Career Development Conference. That is attended by students from all over the world. They come to four locations in the United States. Last year it was in Nashville, this year Anaheim, next year Atlanta, and then Orlando my senior year. Competitors, it's determined on your performance at each conference. So students who rank top fourth in districts and top fifth in states move on to the next level, with ICDC being the ultimate goal. Everyone in DECA says they're going to get glass one day, which means at ICDC, if you place, you get this plaque, and it's you're on the stage in front of 18,000 students from around the whole world. So it's really a really big goal to strive for, and when you're up there, it feels amazing to know that you've accomplished that. In DECA, it is split up into four career clusters, they're called. One is hospitality and tourism, marketing and communications, business management and administration, and finance and accounting. I personally compete in hospitality and tourism, but I know some of my friends compete in the other clusters, and DECA is everything business. It entails marketing, I know one of my questions was product mix, so it's how do we get our product out to the world, and how do we keep it from becoming stale? How do we keep it fresh? How do we keep our customers coming back to us? Each student takes a 100-question exam in correspondence with their cluster. These questions range from if you have a meeting and you want to get like an agenda out to people, what software do you use, what platform do you use, what is the best way to market your products and stuff like that. One of the questions is if you're in marketing, you're a marketing executive, and you really want your ad to stand out from the competitors, what would you do differently from your competitors? And at the, that usually takes place before our role plays. Our role plays are judge situations, so we're presented with performance indicators. And we have to take those performance indicators into account, write responses to those performance indicators, and then read a scenario we are given on the other side. We have 10 minutes to prepare that response and 10 minutes to present it to a judge. DECA also offers written projects. We have something, it's a franchise business plan. So you are looking into opening a franchise of like a McDonald's or a Sonic, and you have to present your plan of how you're gonna start up that business. We have a startup business plan, which is you have your own idea and you take it into this business plan and you present it to a judge. And you provide all your financials, you provide your marketing, you provide your plans of how you're gonna start and maintain your business. And we also have an independent business project. WHS DECA, we had about 120 students go to districts, 45 to states, and 8 will be attending ICDC at the end of April vacation. And we have a leadership board that covers all aspects of running and promoting our club. We have a marketing board. We have the school store committee, which during events, they're responsible for opening the school store and selling items. Competition prep, which I am a member of, and we prepare our new students for our competition so they can see really what it's like. And we have the executive board, and those students are responsible for like the whole operation of the club. DECA is WHS's biggest club, and it's mostly student run. ICDC this year will be in Anaheim, California. We will be staying in the Disneyland Hotel this year. We were kind of far away from everything last year, so we got the good hotel this year. It'll take place April 26th through the 30th, and students all over the world will attend. The networking opportunities that DECA provides, not only at ICDC, but at states and districts with other towns in your district and other communities in your state, are unbelievable. I know we had some seniors last year from Wilmington. They met students that are attending the colleges that they chose. So they already had network connections in those colleges. I will be attending ICDC in a leadership role. What leadership is DECA has this whole campaign that they launch around September, October, and it is a series of tasks that each chapter can choose to either take or not take. These tasks range from anywhere as like a can drive for your community. All of them benefit your community, and you have to do these tasks and prove to DECA that these tasks were completed for your community, and they award you leadership spots. And these academies are designed to help you find your leadership style and effectively turn it out into leadership positions that you may occupy, whether be the leader of a club at school or later on when you enter the real world and you have to apply for a job and you get promoted up into the higher ranks of a company. And that's all I have. Are there any questions, comments?
Any questions, Mrs. Cornish?
So are you on a team or are you an individual competing?
My 2 years in DECA, I have competed individually. Teams are an option, and they follow those same clusters from earlier in the presentation. So there's teams that compete in marketing situations, hospitality situations, and finance. And the writtens are generally done in teams as well. But as far as myself, the past 2 years, I've competed individually.
And the 8 people going, are they all individual, or are there some team?
We have 2 teams going to compete. And 3 leadership spots. So Wilmington High School was awarded 3 leadership spots for our participation in the campaign earlier. And the 4 students that we have competing are both teams.
Great. Thank you. Mrs. Barnes.
I have to say 8 students making it to this level is pretty, very impressive. And I just wish you all the best.
Thank you.
In this competition, because I've always, in this, going into my 6th year of sitting here, I'm amazed at the work and the level of work that DECA puts out. And it's just so impressive, and I'm just rooting for you.
Thank
3,000
you
miles away. I know you'll make us proud. I know you
Thank
all
you.
Will.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Mulis.
Very impressive. I can't believe you're a sophomore. You present better than some of my coworkers, so congratulations.
Thank you.
Being the biggest club in the high school, do freshmen that join tend to stay through the whole 4 years? Are they, is there some drop off during?
We do tend to see some drop off, but I've noticed in my last year as a freshman and in this year with the new freshmen coming in, is they strive to be on that stage at ICDC. So even though they may not make it this year, they say, I'm going to come back next year and I'm going to do better than I did last year. So we see continuous rates throughout, like the freshman, sophomore, all the way up to graduation. And we also see new membership because those freshmen go to their friends and they say, you know, I went to Boston with a bunch of friends and we had a great time and it's awesome, you should do it next year. So word of mouth is a big promotion for DECA.
Mr. Talbot.
What's the highest placement that you've gotten at the ICDC?
I did not place at ICDC last year.
Okay.
I placed first in my category at districts last year, sixth last year, and I got bumped up because one of the top five couldn't make it to Nashville. So I got bumped up into the top five. And I didn't place in ICDC. This year I placed second in districts and seventh in states.
What about the club as a whole? Do you get judged on that and, you know, like how?
The club as a whole, in my 2 years, I've seen one of our seniors last year. She got called up on stage because she placed first in one of her role plays.
Yeah.
It was amazing. It was really amazing. I have heard of some other Wilmington students placing at ICDC. It's more of like we've made it to ICDC.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like the club doesn't really, we don't really go home sad that we didn't place. We go home happy because we were there and we were a part of it.
That's cool. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Very nice. Okay. Peer mentoring.
Explaining a little bit what we do and what we are about. My name is Jocelyn DeFeo, and I am on the junior e-board as a transition specialist. So I work more individually with helping students geared to more individualized needs transition into high school. So as a group, our mentor program helps the incoming freshmen and students who transfer from other schools get acclimated into the high school and go from a 7-block period to a 4-block period, having classes every other day. We show them around the school. We do a bunch of events. Sorry. We do a bunch of events within the school that help the freshmen feel accepted and welcome into the school.
Yeah. Okay. So going off of that, like some events that we run freshman orientation, and we work like basically like different days like throughout the summer and like during finals week to like prepare for this event. And especially this year too, we made it a lot more like one-on-one as in like pairing the mentors but just like one or two freshmen so they could really focus on helping those freshmen get like an easy transition into the high school. And it gets like a lot of people, like especially like in our grade, like the upperclassmen involved in like helping everyone like feel, like as Justin said, feel welcomed in our school. And then another event that we did Mr. and Miss WHS, which is a talent contest, and we got a really big turnout this year. I think he's gonna talk about it a little later, so I'll let him handle that one. And then we also do the cram jam, which happens right before mid-years. And that is just so we can like help out the freshmen in studying for like this big test, because in middle school they don't really have any huge tests like this, but and this like their like first one of the year too. So it gives like the mentors a chance to like help out the freshmen and like studying for their exams and everything. And this year we also made it a lot more like one-on-one again with like they like just helped them like studying like and gave them different like tips for studying. And then we're also getting a lot of our mentors involved in the Special Olympics this year, but people are going to talk about that later. So
My name is Jessica, and I'm on the junior e-board. And this year, the junior e-board was in charge of organizing Cram Jam. And in past years, it was focused more on helping the students with studying tips. But this year, we had it in the library during extra help sessions, so teachers were available as well. And we focused it more on working like on certain subjects the freshmen needed help on. And when we had the mentors sign up for it, we asked them what subjects they felt strongest in. And so when we were organizing it, we put the mentors with the subjects they felt stronger with. We had them separated in different areas in the library. And the freshmen seemed to like this way better, and they worked and learned a lot more.
My name is Mia O'Connell. I'm on the junior e-board with Jocelyn and Jess. And I just wanted to talk about some of our goals for next year. So along with following the example of the senior e-board this year, we also want to increase participation and encourage more meetings to happen, and also make the freshmen feel more comfortable and encourage them to keep communication with their peer mentor throughout the year.
Okay. My name is Cam Pickett. I'm the coordinator of the mentor program for the seniors. I think Ms. Kasten would prefer me to call myself the tyrannical dictator. So I joined for my junior year, and it was very important to me my freshman year because it helped me to be involved with what I saw. And my freshman year, personally, I remember my mentors were amazing, and I remember thinking to myself that I needed to be a part of this group when I got up here. And I actually wrote my college essay about how I joined the club and how it affected my entire high school career after joining it. I think I've helped this club grow, or program, I guess we should call it, helped it to grow, and I've grown with it as well. And like, we've had one of the best years of people to have. I know my other people on the e-board have been phenomenal and helped me in every single way possible that we've made every change we've made to the program has made it so much bigger and better. Like what Jill said about changing the grouping system. I think you said that, right?
Yeah.
Okay, changing the grouping system for the orientation, making it more one-on-one, and making sure people had like more similarities with their mentors instead of having it be like random and then not really following up after our orientation happened. And I also think we worked, like our e-board worked hard to, oh wait, I already said that. I'm sorry. I thought our e-board was a really great team and we all worked together. And the Mr. and Miss program was, or show, I guess, was my favorite thing that we did this year, and it meant the whole, like, it was, we had such a great turnout, and everyone that showed up was amazing, and our king is behind us, he has his crown. I tried my best not to let him win, but yeah, that's about it.
That's great, thank you very much. Any question for our peer mentors?
How many mentors are there?
I think we had 130 or so.
Wow.
And it's all juniors and seniors because no sophomores can join, or I guess we've had a few sophomores in the past, but it's usually juniors and seniors.
And you're like paired up with?
Yeah, so the way we did it this year was one mentor would be with two or three freshmen, and they'd come into tour the high school, and then they'd ask any or take any questions that the freshmen had and help them out throughout the year. And then we did the ice cream social.
I totally forgot about that.
All right. So we run the ice cream social as well.
Yeah.
And that's all of our mentors come, and freshmen come in, they can join clubs at that point, and the mentors that come help their freshmen like know about what each club offers, and that's how a lot of freshmen know about the clubs we offer here.
Fantastic program.
Mr. Mulis.
So all the freshmen set up with a mentor when they come into the high
every
school?
Every freshman that signed, there's like an eighth grade, in the eighth grade there's a slip that everyone, or a paper that everyone gets, and they fill it out with who they want. But if they forget to fill it out, or if it happens that they don't fill it out, they don't get paired up, but then we end up finding a way to get them into a group anyway. So I'd say almost every single freshman get there unless they don't show up to the orientation by any means.
Great. sounds like a great program. Thank you very much. Thank you for your presentation.
Thank you. Very good.
World cultures. Isn't this much more fun?
It's amazing how many wonderful students we have who put so much extra work into things.
Absolutely.
I think it's great that we have, we can give them a forum to talk about this. It makes me want to go back to teaching.
There you go. You can go back.
Hi, everyone. My name is Fariha Haq. I'm a junior, and I'm also the treasurer of World Cultures Club. Pictured here from left to right is our co-advisor, Ms. Velez, me, our vice president, Joanna Shing, secretary, Jackie Shampoo, president, Dina Singh, and co-advisor, Ms. Pietro. So the purpose of World Cultures Club is to give students an opportunity to learn about various cultures all over the world. And we have monthly meetings on the first Monday of every month. And we make presentations based on a country's culture. And then we usually make the presentations with a Prezi or a Google Slides presentation. And after that, we play a Kahoot on it. I don't know if you've heard of that, but it's a fun game that students love to play. And it's really a test, but students get really competitive with it. And it's actually really fun. I take it quite seriously myself. And after that, we one of the officers will bring in food from the country of origin. And we talk about like how it was made and the ingredients involved in the evolution and all of that. So Fun with World Languages is something that we did in previous years with the West and North Intermediate Schools. Members of World Cultures Club would go to the schools to teach students some basic phrases and sentence structures in those languages. And it was originally started to help them decide which language to take in middle school. And we haven't been able to do it in the last 2 years or so because they have had busy schedules, so we couldn't really fit it in. Every year, the World Cultures Club organizes the International Teachers Breakfast. It's where we thank the teachers and the staff for everything that they do. And the members bring in food from their own cultural background. Teachers have done it as well. So this year, the world language teachers have made it a requirement for students to go outside the classroom and learn more about their culture and the language that they're taking in school. So to motivate students to do that, the teachers and World Cultures Club have organized events such as conversation groups, film series, monthly tremezzo cooking workshops, and lunches in Spanish and French. We also had the Culture Fest, which I'll talk about later, but that was one of our biggest events of the year. So conversation groups take place about once or twice per month, I'd say, and they take place during the last 30 minutes of interdisciplinary block. Students have a chance to speak the language that they are taking, and they can play fun games in that language or read magazines or anything like that. We also have lunches once a month. We have lunch in Spanish, which we call almuerzo en español. We also have a lunch in French. I'd say that in French for you guys, but I don't take French, so. So this year, the World Cultures Club partnered up with the Wilmington Memorial Library to co-host the foreign film series. We have presented movies in French, Spanish, and Italian from January to March. And it just gives students another opportunity to go out and learn more about their language. I think the community that students enjoy the most is the Tremezzo cooking workshops. So we partnered up with Tremezzo, and they have been kind enough to allow students to go to these workshops to talk about some cultural dishes and how it was made and like the ingredients involved in making it. And Culture Fest was our biggest event of the year. It was very fun and exciting. So students made displays, food, and performances based on their own country of origin or their culture or just a country that they were interested in overall. And pictured here from left to right is our first, second, third, and honorable mention winners. All the students did a wonderful job of presenting their country and the culture, and it was just a very fun-filled night. And I also have some flyers and programs for you to take a look at if you'd like to.
Sure, thank you.
And we also had some performances done by our own students. This included dancing and singing. Some of the performers actually asked for the audience members' help during their performance, and when we were rehearsing, we weren't sure if people would want to go up, but the night of Culture Fest, like, everyone was getting out of their seats and like rushing to the stage, and there was almost no space left, and it was just a really fun night. With a partial grant from the Wilmington Cultural Council, we were able to bring Inca Son to perform at the Culture Fest as well. And Inca Son is a group of Peruvian folk dancers who really ignited the crowd with their intriguing and unique style of dance. So World Cultures Club fundraises for college scholarships and travel scholarships for students. So the college scholarship is given to a student, a graduating senior, who is committed to take a world language in college. And the travel scholarships are given to students who may need additional funds for any trips to places like Costa Rica and Nicaragua, for example. We also made a Culture Fest cookbook with the help of Ms. Fiddler's graphic design students, Ms. Desberg's English students, and Mrs. Tucker. I have one right here if anyone would like to buy one. They are $5. They go for funds for the travel scholarships and the college scholarships. And that was it. And if you'd like to keep up with us, you can follow our Twitter at @WHS_WCC.
That's great.
Do you work at all with the cultural centers for different cultures that are out there, like the Armenian Cultural Center, which is in Watertown? Have you ever looked into, like, the, you know, like Italian, you know, any kind of like other things that are out there? Because I know they would really be excited to, you know, kind of give you more information.
We haven't done that, but I think that it'd be a good idea for the club as a whole in the future, because I think that like cultural awareness is very important, especially with like things going on in the world today. And I think that that would be a great idea for different towns to partner up. And I can certainly talk to our advisors about that.
Yeah, well, the center is in Watertown. Mm-hmm. But like the library is like in the downtown Watertown area. But that's just Armenian. But I'm just saying in general, with I saw a list of cultural, you know, like things that you did. I didn't know if you partnered up with them to get information from them about their cultures.
Oh, we did not partner up with them, but we, like for Culture Fest, we got some like funds and grants and prizes from different cultural restaurants, but we haven't like reached out to like Watertown or.
Yeah, like I said, it's not the town of Watertown. Mm-hmm. It's just that's where the library is for the cultural center for just Armenian. Mm-hmm. But I mean, they're. I'm sure elsewhere, because I saw you had a booth, so I'm sure that, you know, they would provide some kind of something like that, mm-hmm. something to look into.
Thank you. Great, thank you. Any other questions? World Cultures. Great. I'll take a cookbook. Maybe I'll actually use it. Thank you.
Do you have more than one? That's all
right. Yeah, you can print the whole. Great. A little fundraising going on at the school committee meeting.
Maddie would love that.
Okay.
We're going to do our Christmas shopping.
I know, right? Okay, I think we've got the 9/11 Memorial Committee. We've got you doing double duty tonight, huh?
Triple duty.
Triple duty. Yes.
So the 9/11 Committee was formed to educate future generations about 9/11. And we have a memorial out in the courtyard. And once our memorial was created on 9/11 Day, we have presentations to educate the students at WHS of what happened. And this year we dedicated our 9/11 presentations to the firefighters that helped save people or like died. And we, for our 9/11 project, we decided to raise money for the Wilmington Fire Department to buy new flagpoles for them. And we raised over $250 with a Dining for a Cause at Fuddruckers, and we also sold car magnets. And we entered the 9/11 Day contest as well, and we were one of the 40 schools to win a $200 grant. And we're using this grant to go into Boston to the Garden of Remembrance to visit the memorial set up there. And on that day, we are going to bring the flagpoles over to the Wilmington Fire Department as well.
Comments?
I have a quick question.
Mr. Mules.
How many members in the 9/11?
Like around 20. It's a little small. I joined my freshman year and I've stuck with it.
Do you get a lot of freshmen that join as they come in?
Not really. It's kind of more upperclassmen. I don't know if they know about it or just don't want to join because they don't like really know about it.
You know, we've all lived through 9/11. We all remember, but you know, as kids are getting older, younger kids don't, you know, my kids never witnessed it or anything like that. So it's important to keep that going as kids grow up to know what happened in 9/11. So I congratulate you for what you do.
Thank you.
And commend you for what you do.
That's great. Thank you very much. Okay, I think we have somebody here from Local Heroes. More than one. These kids are so active. It's great.
Hi, I'm Jocelyn again. our Local Heroes Club helps the local servicemen and women in our town and outside of our town as well. Every year we collect the Dear Soldier letters that every school does, and we go through them. We read them and then we send them to, we work closely with a hospital for wounded veterans. I forget where it is.
Walter Reed?
Yes, thank you. We work closely with them and we'll send them down there along with our gratitude scrolls. So for a week every fall, we'll put up scrolls and we'll encourage the high school population to write encouraging messages to our service men and women who have been wounded and who are working in transitioning back into everyday life. We are currently setting up our fundraiser right now, which is where we are sending them toiletries. Half of our donations are going to the hospital and then the other half are going overseas. But a lot of what people don't realize is that they don't have their own toiletries to themselves. So it's like when they're in the hospital, there'll be four people sharing one bottle of shampoo, and they don't have anything to truly call theirs when they're transitioning back. So we're supplying them with something that's their own.
Do you have a list somewhere of the items that you collect?
We do. It's not actually starting until May, so they will be posted in every single school.
Every school building, great.
Each school has a different list. Like, we're asking kindergartners to donate games, and then high schoolers are donating shaving cream, razors, and body wash. So depending on the ages, depends on what we're asking for.
Great, thank you.
Have you thought about putting it up on the website?
I believe we do get it on the website. I know every teacher and faculty is emailed with a list of what their school gets, and I'm not sure if it's on the website or not. We are finalizing the details after vacation.
Any questions?
I just want to thank you and your group for doing this, because those letters and supplies, just to be thought of at a moment of such distress. We have a lot of servicemen coming back with a lot of PTSD and experiences, and that just little piece does such an enormous, has such an enormous impact on those servicemen. And I'm thinking, as you're just talking about what your club does for these servicemen, that I almost wish that you and the 9/11 committee can join forces, because that it is so important not to forget that day. And I think we all remember exactly where we were on that day when news started coming in about that event and how our world changed that day. And all you know is the world as it is right now, but we remember a different world before that. And I thank you, the bottom of my heart, for taking this and the whole group on for being so tentative to this important piece in our country and service.
Great. Thank you. Any other comments or questions? Thank you very much. Okay, we have Model UN and the Debate Club. You can wear your crown if you'd like.
Hi, I'm Mary Robles, and I'm president of Model UN.
I'm Zach Evasion, I'm VP.
I'm Connor Kilbride, I'm secretary / public relations. I have two titles.
Oh, use a clicker.
Yeah.
There we go. All right, so what is Model UN? A lot of people will ask me, like, I'll tell them, hey, I'm VP of this club called Model UN, and most of them won't really know what it is. So it's a model of the UN. I guess I'll give you guys an example of one thing in particular that we did. We'll talk about conferences later, but one time I went to a conference, actually we had it here in this room, and we talked about the Syrian refugee crisis. And each student represented their own in particular country. I think Mary was the United States. I would have been Israel. And Connor.
I was Canada.
Canada. Canada.
Yep.
You got it. And so each student is supposed to represent what his or her country is trying to get across. Like, for example, Israel, we don't really want to take any refugees, compared to like Germany, which wants to take as many refugees as possible. So they're just trying to work together to find a common solution to figure out the big world problems, pretty much.
Yeah, and how it works in the beginning of the year, we all choose which country we want. The upperclassmen get preference. So I had the first pick. I picked the United States, and then someone else like picks, and it just goes down. And then we try to research the position of our countries and try to, you know, support them. Understand it, and we do it in conferences, and we try to support our country's position. And we've been in multiple schools and have won some awards. Like, I won best delegate in my conference, and that was really exciting. That's the highest award you could get. I won a gavel. That was fun. And then it was pretty cool. And then this club is headed by Mr. Hackett, the A Push teacher, and he really inspired all three of us to join Model UN. And I think that we all have better speaking skills and just are confident and love world affairs because of him.
Yeah, like, I know that a lot of people say when we go to these out of school conferences, they'll be talking in front of everybody. So I want to say over 100 people probably.
Yeah.
And they'll say like, hey, before like a year or two ago, before I joined this club, I wouldn't have been able to do this. And I was looking at them like, okay, like that's kind of cliche. Like, we get it. But honestly now, like, I couldn't have done this a year or two ago, but just Model UN itself has just made me so much more confident with speaking in front of people, and it's just helped me, and I think that helps well with college and just life in general.
So this is our picture from our DC trip that we took to the United Nations. We also partnered up with 9/11 Club. They went there too, so it was really fun when we went there last year. I think they're trying to do it every 4 years just to go, and it was a really fun experience. So what do? We do bi-weekly in-school conferences or school debates. So in-school conferences is we have a topic like normal Model UN type thing. We have a crisis council or just a normal conference in which we give an issue, you have to research on it, a background guide. And then we have our in-school debates, which are more about what you or what the student wants to talk about, more about them representing themselves as an individual, kind of like we talk about gun control, their personal opinion on gun control, on some other more controversial topics, which are very interesting to find out their opinion on.
Yeah, and but like I mentioned earlier, we do around roughly like 4 trips per year to different schools around Massachusetts. So St. John's High, St. John's Prep, Boston College High School, and Sandwich High School. We've already done 3 of them, and we're going to Sandwich, I think, the 28th?
Later, yeah.
Last Saturday of the month. And I forget what I'm doing. I think, I want to say around 15 people are probably going.
Yeah.
And it's, like, each out-of-school conference has its own particular niche that it does. Like, for example, Sandwich, I think it's known for having, like, the best desserts, which is pretty great.
Yeah. And in most of these places, we're among like the few public schools there, so it's very good to have like, I don't know, like our small town represented there too.
Okay, so why does it matter? I feel like a lot of people will look at a club, and they'll just look at it with its face value. They won't really look really into it. So that's part of the reason why I'm glad about this meeting. So. It can teach students to see through different perspectives besides their own. I think that's really important for not just Model UN, but for life itself. Because when are you ever going to truly learn anything if you're just stuck in your own ways your whole entire life? You're not. You're just going to be thinking the same old thing and never going to be branching out.
We have open dialogues with our friends about politics, and we're very civil about it, which is surprising in some places. So. Yeah, we could talk about it, we could learn someone's different perspective, someone's different like idea about politics, and we could try maybe like just compromise, just try to understand the other person's perspective. And yeah, and we find solutions about issues that not only impact our government, foreign nations, but including our own community. We talked about what Environmental Club is doing with recycling, and many students were totally in favor of that, and some said that they would love to join the club, or we talked about women's studies, and maybe how we could include more women lit or other things in our curriculum. And
so it can also get more people interested in international and national affairs.
Yeah.
And what I mean by that is that I think up until about junior year, I had no idea what I wanted to do for the rest of my life. I still don't, but I have more of an idea of what I want to do. I think because of this club, I want to do something with politics, preferably like a political science major, and then possibly branching out from there. And honestly, I never would have gotten into this if it wasn't for Model UN. I will go home, this sounds kind of nerdy, but I'll go home and I'll watch YouTube videos on current events and like history and what's going on in the world. And I never would have been interested in that if I hadn't joined this club. So for me in particular, this is really important to me, and I care a lot about it. And I think that a lot of other students in the club do too.
Yeah.
There you go. And this is the...
And that's us.
Yeah, that's us.
That's some of our members. A lot of them were missing because of other clubs at the time, but we have like...
About 40 to 50-ish.
Yeah. One of the largest clubs in the school. And just ignore me up front. Sometimes just gotta pose. It's all good though.
So, I think that's it.
Yeah.
That's it.
Any
yeah.
questions?
That's great. Questions, comments? Mr.
Mulis. I'm very impressed that, you know, guys your age are getting involved in world events and politics and political science. I usually don't see that until you, you know, college years and beyond that. So on a personal note, what do you guys do to keep up with what's going on in the world as far as where countries stand, you know, being part of the UN group. And what kind of media are you guys reading, watching news? What is it that keeps you, how do you keep informed of what's going on?
I normally just watch the big three, like news channels, Fox, CNN, MSNBC. But at the same time, we also talked about this whole circulation of fake news or some news that are not trustworthy. So I think some of us just look for our own news media outlets and try to see if they're verified or not.
Yeah, like honestly, sometimes it's hard to tell if it's, you know, what you're looking for is really the right story. And no matter where you look, I think that your news media is going to be biased in some form. Mm-hmm. So I think that's really important to get your sources from multiple outlets, not just one. Like, for example, like I try to get my news from more than just, say, like NBC. Like, I try to branch out just so that maybe someone else has a different take on the story.
Do you guys all tend to have different views politically, or?
There's a wide variety of views in the clubs. There's some very, very far right and some very far left. A few of them graduated, but they were just
right, but
not that far right. But you know, a decent amount to the right. And some of them graduated, but they were very easily replaced by others who wanted their opinions to be heard. But when you go to the actual conferences, your personal opinions don't matter. Like, you can be very pro-United States and get assigned North Korea, so your patriotism does not matter. And you have to express your own country's opinion instead of your own personal opinion. But there's a big, gap between. It just allows for a lot of good discussions when we have in-school conferences.
Okay, Mrs. Bonish.
So I just wondered, you obviously have a lot of members. How do you market this? Like, how do you get people to join?
Well, I mean, I think that one of the big ways, especially for freshmen, is the ice cream social, like you guys host. This year, and my freshman year as well, we made brownies, which was a pretty big hit. They were out in, like, the first half hour, I think. So we got to learn a bunch of people with that. And I think that's been a large contributor as well, just word of mouth. Like,
we have remind texts too. So yeah. They're informed beforehand when we're going to have a club meeting. Connor takes attendance. And attendance is a very big factor because in the end of when the club ends, we have a big banquet. Everybody just brings food, everything, and we even give, well, this year we're going to give underclassmen awards to those who participate the most or who show up the most.
But nobody knows that, so.
Nobody knows that, so.
Keep it quiet.
When you start at the beginning of every year or whatever, do you give a little presentation like this to you know, welcome people and tell them what it's like?
Yeah.
We also tell them, like, the rules of Model UN and then how, because at the first time, they're not very comfortable with it. They don't really know. But they have the conferences to go to, in-school conferences to get more comfortable. They know how to represent their country. And, they participate a lot.
Like, I know a lot of freshmen, me myself included, they talk usually less than the upperclassmen, which is fine. They're just trying to get used to what's going on in front of them. So we try to branch out with them as much as possible. But when it comes down to it, we kind of see what's going on.
So on that slide where you showed the schools you're visiting, I made note before you mentioned it that three of the four were private schools.
Yeah.
How many schools do you actually visit? It's not just those four, right?
It is those four.
Those
four
are the only ones in the state that are active?
No, there's four schools that host conferences, but there's schools that do all visit the conferences.
Yeah.
How many?
About 20 at least.
Yeah, there are
across the state in New England. I know, it's fine. There was one at the last conference that came from Connecticut. I think that might have been, St. John's.
Yeah.
One of the St. John's schools had, they're like the big introductory conference for the year that makes students like comfortable for the first time public speaking. So they have a bunch of schools come from all over.
So that actually, you probably just led into my follow-up. Is there opportunities to go out of state and visit other states these conferences and competitions?
I mean, we would be able to. It's just that with the distance and the cost of it, like each student has to pay for his or her own ticket.
Yeah.
whatever you want to call it. And it's usually, I want
to
say,
range
what
is like
it?
$50 to $60.
Yeah, which is fairly expensive. So we, Mr. Hackett, he usually does all the planning for the out-of-school because he knows all the advisors. He usually ends up planning only four because it's pretty much, you know,
I do have
as much
to
as we can afford.
We talked to Mr. Hackett before, though. Before we showed up, he did visit, I think it was
George
like
Washington.
George Washington University in Washington, obviously, like 7 years ago, I think. But he hasn't done that since then. But there are opportunities to go out of state if enough kids are interested and they have the money.
Okay. Okay.
Great, thank you. Any other? Mr.
Talbot. Have you tried to do any like fundraisers to kind of, you know, sell candy, sell something to offset it?
Actually, I was just talking to Mr. Hackett about this a few weeks ago. Apparently, they didn't do it when I was a freshman. So before that, they did do some fundraisers, but I'm not sure exactly what happened. I think that there just wasn't enough in public interest in the club. But I was actually just talking to him recently, and my work was just telling me how they're looking for fundraisers. So we're probably going to try to organize one before the end of the year.
I know like a few of the restaurants in the area do like Chili's and Tremezzo, and maybe talk with the guys at DECA about, you know, how to get a business plan going.
If we can't get it done this year, we're at least going to try to get it done.
No, we're
going to
get it done
next year. Yeah, for at least for next year, because maybe we won't have it for our conferences, but maybe for the next year's conferences.
We'll be gone, sadly.
No, we'll try to help them.
On to better things in college.
In college.
Any other questions or comments? No, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Nice talk. Alrighty, best buddies.
Hello.
Hello.
I'm Stephanie Burns. That's just not us, but whatever. Okay. I've been involved in Best Buddies since I was a freshman. I'm a junior now. I became president my sophomore year when the senior graduated. Best Buddies is a social club where we try to involve students at our school with disabilities to participate in high school activities where they normally wouldn't or they're normally uncomfortable to do that. And we try to help and build onto their social skills and improve their self-confidence. So we meet twice and once a month. So when there's like a vacation, we only meet once that month. So we do a lot of arts and crafts, and we got to do kickball in the gym more than once, where they all love that. And then
we have some pictures.
Yes.
The first picture you guys are going to see is of our very own Ryan Holman.
Thank you, Ryan. Game during their break one time, and it was like a giant hit, so I was like, oh my god, I gotta do some Best Buddies. So we did it. It's a lot of fun. And outside of the club, we do, during interdisciplinary block, we go down and meet Miss Norma Drum, who is also our advisor, and we really just have like a social thing. We play games, we talk, that kind of stuff. I also have all the kids and Best Buddies come to my house after, whenever we're doing stuff. And we go to homecoming, spring fling, prom. That's you, bud.
This year, during Martipella, we took Caitlin, Cammy, Stella, and Emily there, and they really enjoyed hearing all the different groups. And it was, like, a good opportunity for them because not all of them would have come without, like, us or, like, even with their parents and stuff. And they enjoyed it.
prom where the three of us are juniors, and Cami and Stella are also juniors, and the five of us went to prom last Friday, and it was amazing. Stella would have had to go with her sister instead of a group of friends, and Cami probably wouldn't have gone.
Yeah, she didn't want to go for like 2 weeks before.
Yeah, she it took a lot of convincing to get Cami to go to prom, but they both had an amazing night, and Stella danced the entire night away. Yes. She had a huge smile on her face the entire night, and without Best Buddies, they wouldn't have had that option. Stella would have had to go with her older sister, and Cami would have never experienced it.
Along with that, we do fundraising, which are always successful. I'd say we probably raised about over $1,000 since I was the first person to fundraise for the club. So,
yeah. We do a couple fundraisers each year.
Yes. The girl, Cami, who was mentioned earlier, her mother passed away last year. It was a year since her mom died, and it's just her and her dad now. So we have a medical fund set up for her. She has cerebral palsy, and she's very, very severe. So with that, we do fundraising twice a year for her medical fund. Big hit. And this club has actually got me to know what I want to do. I want to be a special ed teacher when I graduate, so... That's about it.
Going off of the fundraising, we work with Chili's. Last year we did a Chili's fundraiser. We did, we made a basket. It was a summer raffle basket, which brought in more proceeds. And like with the 99s, the Chili's allowed us to do 10% of the check.
Yes.
10% of the check when they presented the flyer went to Cami's medical fund, which helped her and her dad a lot.
Questions for the girls from Bus Buddies?
Everybody's jumping at it. Mr. Bjork and then Mrs. Burns.
How long has the club been in existence?
It's been in existence for 9 years.
What a fantastic club. I wish it had been around a lot longer. Thank you, ladies, for what you do.
When we started the life skills program here at the high school, mm-hmm. and I was asked, I volunteered for first several years, it was just me volunteering to do it, and then before Mrs. Benton left, she did make an official club, and now I do get a small stipend, but I would do it for free. I love it. I think it's really important for the kids, and these girls, they're the best. They really and truly are.
Thank you.
Mrs. Burns.
I truly, just to echo, you stole my thunder, and I don't mind giving it up. I do want to having two special needs children, the opportunity that you offer those students who may not otherwise take those opportunities to mingle with their classmates mm-hmm. and or experience what every student should experience in their career, in academic career. You know, those high school proms and sporting events and the concerts. It means the world to have that peer role model as a parent. To have that, I can only speak as I apologize, but when it's so important to have that connection between typical peer, because it's not just once you leave high school, it's a whole big world and it's a whole big community to navigate, and everyone should go on their own adventures, and to have you hold their hands as they experience that and navigate their world in the larger world, mm-hmm. it's phenomenal, and giving. You know, all students that chance to participate is just, I thank you for that, because it's not always easy. And is this a club that is in the middle school, or is it was this discussion about?
It's in the middle school.
It is an offered club at the middle school. Yeah. I don't know if it's active this year or not.
Okay. It is not active this year. It was active last year. They didn't have a teacher advisor for it this year.
They actually, Mrs. Bellio at the middle school is doing it this year.
Oh, she is?
Yeah, yeah. So it has been able to continue, which is great, because I'm hoping that a lot of those kids will be able to move up to the high school and continue the activities there.
That's wonderful. Thank you very much.
Mr. Mulis.
Just a quick question. Are you guys associated with, like, Best Buddies with, like, the New England Patriots are associated with? And Tom, so just the same name, but.
Yeah.
Just curious.
Any other questions or comments? No? Okay. Thank you very much, ladies. I think we have our staff member, Diana Hill, who's going to share with us some information about Special Olympics.
Brought some of our athletes too.
Excellent.
Awesome. Either of you guys, do you want to sit?
Yes.
So these guys have been participating in the Special Olympics probably longer than I have been here. This is my sixth year, and the Special Olympics is something that goes on every year. We typically go to the Lawrence School Day Games, but we're limited with how many students we can bring. Last year, I believe there were only 7 students who went, so the idea came into mind, why don't we bring it to Wilmington and get more students involved? And so that was a pretty big undertaking. We got involved with the Special Olympics. We approved it with Ms. Peters, and we've been doing this since about September. There's a committee of 6 of us. It's myself, one of my ed assistants, Mary Lou McDonough. There is Jen Mahan, Tim Alberts, the athletic director, Dan Cadigan, our resource officer at the high school, and Becky McGrath, who is one of the board members of We're One Wilmington. We meet at least on a monthly basis. Now that we're getting closer, we meet once a week just to make sure that we're doing everything we need to. So we're gonna have an event 2 weeks from now on April 27th. It will be the first annual Wilmington School Day Games. We're hoping to make this a continuous event and hopefully work out the kinks this year. I know there have been a little communication issues. We're gonna make the best of it, get as many kids involved as we can. We have about 160 participants. We did invite some elementary students from Burlington who are gonna be joining us. They were trying to get in on the ground floor with us to be part of it. And then about a month ago, we only had about 20 athletes registered, and we were panicking that we weren't going to have enough athletes, so we brought them on board. They're bringing about 30 students with them, and that's in the number of 160. We have about 85 volunteers. Most of them are the peer mentors that you met earlier. I'm really excited to see them take the helm on the day. It's really going to be them who are running the event. And I have a lot of confidence that they're going to do really well with it. We are going to have Soundscape singing the national anthem. So we got a nice sampling of that, which is going to be awesome. We're just trying to get as many students involved as possible. One thing that the Special Olympics is switching to is a unified model of Special Olympics where the athletes, who are the individuals with intellectual disabilities, are paired up with a peer who is a buddy. So we have 80 athletes and 80 buddies who will all be participating and working for their own medals. And this is probably the first time that I have seen a unified event, and I'm really excited to see that. But back to all the other students that were getting involved, we're going to have the band playing some pep band music as the students are arriving. We have the cheerleaders who are going to be out there cheering on the students and getting the crowds really excited. I've heard a lot of teachers saying that, you know, during their lunch breaks, they're going to be coming out and bringing whatever students they can out to cheer on the students. So I think it'll be really a great event where these guys can show off their talents to all of their peers. Did you guys want to add anything?
Is Mark going to be there at Special Olympics?
He will be. Yes, we have a student who just aged out of our program. When they turn 22, they age out, and he is going to be reciting the athlete's oath during the opening ceremony.
Fantastic.
And who else is going to be? Who else do we know in this school who is going to be in the Special Olympics besides Mark? Well, that's good.
Yes, a lot of your friends from the Best Buddies Club, the students from the Strides program, the students from Mrs. Norman's class, and all of their buddies.
Well, that's good to hear.
Are you guys excited?
Yeah, I'm so excited. I can hardly wait.
I'm excited because we get to go out and we get to take a break from doing schoolwork. And I'm excited that we get to do a lot of working out, a lot of exercise, and we get to do a lot of walking and running,
yes,
and a lot of exercise.
And also I can hardly to play to run 100, run in the track, and a throw tennis ball. No, I can do it, make it stronger and stronger and stronger.
I can't wait. I'm not sure if I can run faster. My legs are too.
You're gonna run as fast as you can.
Yes.
And I can't wait to run fast and then throw tennis balls.
Yes.
And hopefully we can win.
Yes.
We can win the game, the Special Olympics.
One thing, these guys probably aren't aware of, we're doing a rotational model this year, so there are going to be 8 different stations. They are going to compete in their running and throwing events that they're talking about, but there are also going to be other events such as soccer skills, football skills, a relay race, and an obstacle course. And also Olympic Town, we're going to have a DJ and crafts and fun for students who just are having need a break from the events or just need some downtime.
That's great. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Any questions?
Well, you are welcome.
Mrs. Burns.
Do all the students do each station? Is that how they do?
Yes. Yes, so the middle schoolers and high schoolers sign up for one track event and one field event, which they will compete and receive medals in. But everyone has an opportunity to do every station. The elementary schoolers will get a participation medal.
And so, I'm excited to get more medals.
I'm excited for you.
Woo!
I'm excited for all of you. Go team!
Go medal!
Absolutely.
Let's go!
Let's go
Wildcats!
You know it. Make us proud, right, guys?
Yeah.
Thank you very
thank
much
you.
For coming.
Thank
we appreciate
you
it.
Guys.
Thank you.
Good luck. Good luck, guys.
Bring home the gold.
That's it.
That's
great. There you go. Next, we have Max Hubbard.
I'm Max's agent.
Excellent.
Max, come down. I'm not out here by myself. Take a seat, Max. I'm Bill Manchester. I'm the high school math CTL, and I'm going to talk about Max here for a little bit. You got to get that set up to put your tab on. He is the computer expert. Max is a student in my AP Calculus class. Max was the Wilmington High School April Student of the Month for math. And I'm going to talk a little bit about him as a student. He's unbelievable in class. He's technologically sound. If we gave him 30 seconds, he would have figured out a password. and he helps all the kids with obviously all the graph and calculator needs. He's come up with programs in about 20 minutes. I took programming when I was in college, a long time, 20 plus years ago, and where I got to, there's many branches, and he summarized all of the programming world in about 20 minutes and gave me a much better understanding. I had to take some notes here. Max is going to be attending UMass as a computer science major next year, and one of the things, he's obviously very good at programming. Last spring, he taught Wilmington High School students a Java programming class. And one of the things we have up here is he created a app of a game called Maze Trials. He spent about 2.5 months, a couple hundred hours of coding time to get it done, and it's up for sale, so if you want to purchase this. It is a very challenging app. I'm looking forward to next week where I have some time. I can actually play it because I get frustrated even at the easy level. But I think you said you've had about 750 downloads, and
yep.
he gets Wonderful. A small stipend. I think you've made about $100 total. So in the future, many clubs will be coming to him for donations because you're going to be ruling the world. So, and again, another amazing student here at the high school. It's great to sit here and watch all the students. And I don't think Max would have liked to pat his own back, so I'm here to do that for him. So. Grill them. Go get them. Ask some questions.
Thank you.
Thank you.
No problem.
Just show us the game.
All right. So this is Maze Trials. The purpose behind it was to help improve memory skills. So what it does is, let's see.
I don't think he'll be able to play it on here.
I can't play it on here. It creates a sort of maze from given height and width dimensions. And the goal is to obviously reach the end of the maze. You do not know what the maze looks like when you first get there. So as you can see, here you'd start at the spaceship and you try to get to this planet here. My graphic design skills are not that great, but this is the best I could do. As a user, you would tap on the start, and then you'd keep tapping on the different stars next to each other to find the path to the end. If you tap on a star that is correct, it glows green. If it's incorrect, it glows red. When it glows red, you need to retrace your steps back to the start before you can start again. So it's through trial and error where the user has to figure out the correct path to reach the end. And then through these trials in the maze, you can receive coins, which you can use to purchase hints that tell you different places in the maze that are correct. Mm-hmm. You can also purchase different themes. So this right here is the default theme. The favorite theme that I made is the space theme. Let's see, what other themes are there? I didn't display any other themes on here, but there's winter themes, sports themes, anything you could want. There's also a create your own maze theme, where based on different parameters, you can create your own maze, as seen here. That's basically the app itself.
That's great. So we have a Wilmington High School student who's developed an app that's being sold on iTunes.
Yes.
That's pretty cool,
pretty
I'm
amazing.
Thinking.
The
I'm
beginning
thinking
of
that's
the global
pretty cool.
Global
yeah. Mrs. Bonish.
How many downloads do you have? 700?
750.
Good.
752.
752.
753
right.
when I get home.
Yeah. Right. It's challenging. It's fun.
Great, Mrs. Bonish.
Just a quick question. With the 120, is there a time increment?
Yes.
How's that playing to you? I'm intrigued.
So with every difficulty level of easy, medium, or hard, the time interval gets greater. So say this right here is the easy level. You get 120 seconds to complete the maze. If you don't complete it within that time,
does he yell at you or something?
You lose.
Stupid! No, I'm just kidding.
Same thing with this lives feature up here.
Yeah.
So when you get one wrong and you have to retrace your steps, if you get another one wrong as you are retracing your steps, you lose a life, and you have to restart again. If you run out of lives, you lose.
Can you buy lives?
You cannot. But the lives reset with every game.
Okay.
So, and you get more lives, so this is a medium level. You get 180 seconds for that and 5 lives
wow.
for it. Or if you create a maze, you can customize the time and the amount of lives that you want.
Mrs. Bonish.
I'm just wondering how you came up with this idea. I mean, not the programming, I get that, but how did you, like, visualize it in your mind before you even started programming it?
So 2 years ago, I came up with technically this game, a very early version of it. I programmed it in the Java programming language for just a computer desktop, not even for any iOS devices. And it was very bare bones. It didn't have any amazing graphics as it does now. But I just wanted to challenge myself to make something that I had never attempted to make before, and I also wanted to make something that was challenging in itself, that something that I couldn't even get every time, and I still can't get it every time. But that's where the idea came from.
And is it, I'm sorry, just asking technical questions. Is it, like, where is the server for this? Like, wait, do you, the...
So, the way that Apple runs their things, once you have all the code for it and it's all compiled and everything, you submit it to Apple's sort of, I want to say, developer portal, which is called iTunes Connect. And they host the game there and any apps that you make, and it allows them to be sold on the store. Wow.
Thank you. Mrs. Keene?
This fascinates me because I have no idea what you're doing here, as they all know. But what I wanted to ask you is, did you have any education or read any books, or what? How do you just get started to do this?
So 6 years ago, I taught myself how to do this over the summer because I was bored. I didn't feel like reading any of my summer reading books. So
those aren't useful. Yeah, there's not too coding, no reading.
So I just wanted to find, I guess, a new trade. So I Googled, how do I program something? And many hours of YouTube videos later, I just kept trying different things, and eventually, years later, I've just been doing it.
Do you think it's something like that you just you have this ability that is not usual, but it's just something special that you have? Because what I can't stand is that I can't read it, and I can't get the directions, A, B, C, D, that there's so many things on the internet that are directionless, as far as I can see. And I just can't believe, I have a grandson who's very good at this too, but he can't explain to me how he gets it, he just knows it. But how does that happen to you?
I mean, it's kind of one of those things where you just sort of feel it, you know, especially even when I'm programming, like, it just comes as I type it. I don't really have to think about it all that much.
Right.
Whatever I want, I can just sort of visualize in my head and then copy it down.
That is wonderful. And this is going to sound terrible with all the teachers in the room, but I hope that education doesn't push it out of you. In other words, take away the creativity, because I feel very often that's what we do. Because we have someone like me who I know, I'll know it if you write it down. But if you don't write it down, I'm not going to get it, so I better make sure you write it down on everything I give you. You know, and sometimes I feel that can happen. So protect yourself and go with what you know, is what I would tell you.
Mr. Bjork.
So you're a senior this year?
Yes.
Math is not my strong suit, but you're telling me 6 years ago, so that was before ninth grade. Are you looking for investors?
Start now. Start now. Exactly.
Do you have another? Do you have another app that you're working?
Currently, I am working on another.
Tell them.
Yeah, I didn't put any money up yet, right?
That's $1,000 meeting.
Is this Shanti?
It's a very silly app where you control a spaceship, and using the gyroscope that is inside of the phone, you turn a little earth with a bunch of cows on it, and then then it's your job as a spaceship to go around and collect all the cows while avoiding asteroids.
Pretty cool. Gives me something new to try versus Candy Crush. I'm getting a little bored with it. Any other comments, questions? That was
That's
very
fantastic.
Cool, Max. Thank you very much. And then I think last for our student presentations, I think we have a surprise. Do we have a surprise?
Uh-oh.
Uh-oh.
I recognize the student.
This kid looks kind of familiar.
I just wanted to speak on behalf of all the students here that presented. We wanted to say thank you. And we have a small token of our appreciation for you.
Oh,
download for that app?
Thank you so much.
That's great, thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, that's great.
And I especially wanted to thank my mother for her 6 years here. You've made our experiences, all of our experiences here better in the Wilmington school system, so thank you.
Thank you.
That gives me a nice little segue. We just want to say thank you, Jenny, for all that you have done for Wilmington schools and Wilmington students. And there's a plaque in recognition of your time on the Wilmington School Committee.
Oh, very nice.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Thanks, everybody. That was nice. Appreciate it.
The check.
Thank you very much.
Great. Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I just wanted to say thanks so much for all the students. You took time out of your nights to come and be with us. I know I'm refreshed. This is a heck of a lot more fun than some of the evenings that we've had. I would like to see us continue this tradition maybe once, twice a year, and showcase some of the students, not just at the high school, but maybe at the lower grades as well.
It's a wonderful idea.
We have some wonderful talent, and I think sometimes we forget to focus on the kids. That's why we do this job.
Yep.
Great?
Yep.
And now we have to move on to the business part. So our next item of business, we have a couple of policies that we need to do a first reading on. Our Wilmington School Committee Policy Subcommittee met on April 4th and reviewed and discussed the attached policies. At our meeting tonight, we will be presented with a first reading. And we have policy JLCD, which is administering the prescription and non-prescription medication to students. And we also have a new policy, the screening, brief intervention, and referral to treatment, which ESPRT, is that the proper acronym? And that is also a first reading. And generally has been our tradition, we read these, we take a look, any questions or comments, discussion, and then we usually move on and actually vote on it at a subsequent meeting. I think you'll see that there is, in our packets, there is the verbiage for the policies, followed by the original policy in the first case, so you can see the changes made. Okay, and maybe Mrs. Bonish, since you're the chair of our subcommittee for policies, any comments or anything that we should be aware of?
No. So for the prescription one, I'm sure people read it, but I think the biggest difference was that that the nursing staff has to administer the medication rather than the old one said when a school nurse wasn't present that someone else can administer it, but it has to be administered.
Has to be a nurse. Okay. Mr. Bjork?
If I could just add one thing, just credit to our to Doreen Crowe, because the ESPRT policy, it's something that we do have to have as an accepted policy in the very near future, and very few schools actually have moved forward with creating these policies yet. So thank you very much, Doreen, for jumping on this as quickly as you did.
Great. Mrs. Crescent, you're in the audience. Would you like to make any comments or draw our attention to any points?
No, I don't have any comments. I think that we had a good discussion at the subcommittee meeting. I do want to acknowledge that Dr. Maddox is here, our school physician.
Great.
If you have any questions, we can answer them or for anything, okay?
Okay, great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mrs. Burns.
Just a clarification. I know last year when I sat on the policy, we had focused on this administration piece. And that change from the previous policy, we seem to be growing. I just wanted, for clarification purpose, was that taken out in last year's policy with regards to the administration? I know that it was only, I'm just looking for that clarification, how this policy has grown and been reworded. So I didn't know if you could, any historical background, I can't recall it myself. But I know that we updated this last year.
Yeah, so I think that I wasn't involved in the review of the policy, I should have been.
Okay.
And so the clarification was needed on the delegation piece and what we're actually registered for.
Very good.
Okay.
Thank you very much, that helps, thank you.
Mrs. Kane.
I'd just like to take a moment to, Dr. Maddox, it's so nice to see you, I only see you with Madison and Jared, the grandchildren. But in all the years I've been on the board, the doctor has never come here to this meeting. So I wanna thank you so much for coming, Doreen, it's nice of you to invite, I'm assuming you invited him. And it's good to see you, and I know half of this community is gonna be thrilled to know that you're the doctor. Just so happy to have you.
Thank you. I think that, you know, Dr. Sullivan did this role for a long time. And I think there's a change generationally in what the state is expecting from the medical community in terms of helping the schools. So I think that what he did for many years was really everything that was expected. And I think that I'm happy to be here, but I think part of what you're seeing by me being here is a reflection of things just being different and hopefully evolved. And so I appreciate the opportunity, and I would just echo what you said about how fortunate you are to have Doreen. She's excellent, and she makes my role very easy.
Great. Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
That's great. Any other questions or comments on these two? And correct me if I'm wrong, I think usually we do a first reading of it, and then we add it to a subsequent agenda, and we actually take the vote at that point. Okay, great, thank you. All right, Mr. Gallagher has been awfully patient. I asked him to be willing to rotate so we could have the kids come in first, but I know he's prepared a nice update for us regarding some of the work he's been doing for us.
Set this up for you. While we're waiting, should we watch the zombie video again?
That's great.
Have to follow that. Transition. This is where we need the commercial break.
And the slide deck that he's going to share with us was given to us through email. Okay, we did not print it out. There's a number of pages there, but there's some great information.
Yeah, I think it's in your packets too, right?
In the
back?
Not the slide deck, but the overview is.
Oh, okay. All right, well, first of all, this is actually perfect because some of the information that I'm gonna talk about really ties into a lot of those presentations that you saw by the students and kind of some of the fundamental changes that are happening in education, not only in the Commonwealth, but across the nation. So first I'd just like to recognize, I think a lot of people, so I'm presenting a lot of wonderful initiatives, but there's a lot of people that are heading these up, working side by side, and from the principals, the district, curriculum leaders, the CTLs, curriculum team leaders, lead teachers, faculty, support staff, and just want to thank them for their dedication and commitment to the children of Wilmington. And also, I'd also like to take a moment and thank Ms. Ippolito, who's for her years here at Wilmington and who's moving on to a new leadership role. So a lot of these educators that are in Wilmington have been instrumental in kind of maintaining the greatness in the schools. So I've just been very fortunate working with some wonderful professionals over the past few months. Also, the next portion, or I just wanted to show a kind of a brief video. When we're talking about 21st century learning, I'm a big picture person in the sense of kind of seeing where we're going to go. And then this is really some of the grassroots of the work that we're doing here for this year and kind of the work that was begun in looking at a 21st century learning classroom. So you hear that term a lot, but I think this is a short video that kind of shows you where this generation is, you know, and, you know, and this is how we're adjusting from a traditional teaching position towards a 21st century learning position. And I think this really frames this whole presentation today as we move forward. So hopefully this works. If not, then we'll skip it. We'll try one more. My tech guy behind me, sitting quietly.
Put you to work.
Don't you have the night off with all this technology?
I know. Is it? Oh, yeah, it's late. Yeah, it should come right up, right? There you go. Is that it? Oh, you know what? Maybe I wasn't. All right, we'll try. If not, unless I kept clicking it. This is the. We were here earlier just to make sure this all.
Of course.
Murphy's Law.
Of course.
Unless it's. Should we close out and just restart it? Maybe. Let me try it again. We'll start from the beginning. There we go. All right, let's try it again.
I'm on my computer a lot. Mail, Docs, Snapchat.
Technology has revolutionized our world. We can connect and learn and create and share. We have immediate, improved, personalized access to the world. Nothing in our modern lives remains untouched by this powerful transformation, except for education. The big idea behind blended learning is combining online learning in brick and mortar schools with teachers, where students can learn at their own pace so that they can optimize their individual learning.
Combining the best of teacher instruction and computer-based instruction.
The world that we live in today isn't about paper and pencil, it's about computers. Having our kids become comfortable and familiar with that now is going to better prepare them for the world when they leave the school.
Blended learning can actually personalize for every student's individual needs to meet them where they are when they need it.
We are doing students and ourselves a great disservice to assume they all learn in the same way, so we need something new, and that's blended learning.
When you walk into a blended learning school, what you will see is small groups of students off with their computers working away on online learning programs, and another group of students in small groups doing rich interactive projects with each other and really collaborating as peers.
I'm able to now focus on smaller groups of kids, give them more individual attention, and help them with their individual learning styles.
Before, you're moving at the pace of the average of your 30 kids. Now you can really move at the pace of each individual student.
The teacher has the opportunity to look at data in the moment, in the minute, to know where our kids are immediately, informs instruction in the next period or the next morning.
In a regular classroom, it might take a week for you to get your test back. I can take a test twice in one class, get my feedback almost instantly, and figure out what I need to improve on.
Blended learning makes you in charge of your pathway, knowing how to navigate what you need and when you need it.
And that's true learning and knowledge. It's when you're able to apply content into real life.
All 50 million of America's students deserve the opportunity to have blended learning so that they can personalize their education and realize success in life.
50 million.
50 million
students. 50 million students.
50 million students.
50 million. 50
million
students
in America.
In America. 50 million students in America.
And I think that's a really kind of a nice video that kind of ties into the work that we're doing. And so when you look at all of that that was going on in the classroom, that's kind of like where we want to be down the road. And I think the job, you know, as the assistant superintendent and working with all the curriculum leaders is to make sure we're providing the professional development to get there. So I think when we look at the professional development and kind of the work that we've done this year, you can start to see the grassroots of us building towards that blended learning classroom or that 21st century classroom. And then as we look, it really starts, and I'm not gonna go through the big teacher evaluation cycle, but the teacher evaluation cycle, I think this year we utilized it to our advantage. Especially with the SMART goals and looking at our curriculum work, right? So the CTLs and a lot of our curriculum leaders throughout the district, the professional practice goal is that stage one mapping. So you have an entire group, an entire department, in some cases an entire school pulling in the same direction. So when you have those department meetings, everyone continues to work together and really talking the common language. That's your cycle of, that happens every year, the evaluation cycle for all of our educators, and as we know through the DESE, that's the law. So looking at curriculum mapping, I just try to break this down. These are the essentials when teachers start to meet and they start to develop the lessons. You know, really looking at every unit is, before you even start planning, is, you know, what do you want the students to learn? What do you want them to know, and what do you want them to be able to do? And then as underneath, you start to develop the power standards and the essential questions. The other big piece of that is how are you going to know they really learn the material? And that's when you start looking at those authentic assessments, right? The formative assessments versus the summative. And then during the class, how are you generating the data to really analyze the learning? And that's where your common assessments are coming in, your rubrics. And then ultimately, what I think teachers and all of us that we're pretty good at when you start looking at the DCAP, you know, what are the interventions when students don't learn? But one of the biggest challenges for our teachers today is students are coming into our classes where they already learned the material. So they're coming in, you know, through the internet and through, you know, we just heard Max saying what he did for fun over a summer. He created an app. So if you're a math teacher and you want to bring him back to an Algebra 1, maybe a low-level basic, you know, math class, he's already way up here. So I think for us today, for our educators, it's really looking at developing strategies for the students that are coming in already at a higher level. That already know the material, and then challenging them to move on. So that's like the big frame when you're developing the lessons, right? And so when we're talking about the curriculum maps, and when you hear stage one, stage two, here it's really a summary of what we're looking at. So the stage one is developing the essential questions or the standards. And when you're looking at the standards, we used to work with faculty and curriculum leaders in developing the essentials for every unit. What do students, what are the must knows? What do they have to know after this unit that are non-negotiables? And pulling out the must knows versus the needs to knows. And then as you develop upper level classes or an honors and AP course, those nice to knows you start to incorporate in the needs to knows. And that's your stage one. Stage two is, just as we talked about, your summative and formative assessments. So as you're learning that material, your formative assessments are the ongoing daily assessments where you're really understanding what the students are understanding during that day, and then in preparation for a summative. Our old days, we would have that unit test at the end of the month, right? That's your summative assessment. Today, with ongoing feedback, you want to take that bigger assessment and break it in, you know, usually like 2 weeks. So you're providing more summative assessments, but on the daily basis, your formative assessments are the ongoing feedback. And then stage three of curriculum mapping is really your lesson plans and the resources you need. And that all ties in to what you want students to know, what you want students to understand, and the big piece is what do you want them to do. So when you're looking at the students that were articulating their projects and some of their, you know, outcomes, you know, from DECA to they're learning a lot of those strategies in the classroom, but they're really applying it to real life. And those are the what you want them to do. Yes.
Sorry to interrupt. I didn't want to. I almost looked at these stages,
mm-hmm.
and I was a little confused,
mm-hmm.
that I would see, I would kind of anticipate, maybe might be old school, seeing lesson plans and resources,
mm-hmm.
Be more stage two format, and then the evaluation summer informative,
mm-hmm.
so that you could expand upon, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And
so how does that work? It's like the, if we take this presentation.
Yeah.
So you take your big question, right? So
mm-hmm.
we just saw a video where what we want our classroom to look like.
Right.
Right? So then that's your stage one, right?
Right.
That's the standard.
I got right there.
And then you backfill with your lesson plans and resources for the teachers. Like when we talk about one-to-one technology training,
yep.
when we talk about the resources that they're going to need to get there, that's really your stage three. But when you're curriculum, when you're developing your curriculum, it all comes together in the beginning. It's hard to just start off with stage one.
Mm-hmm.
So what we're finding by working with a lot of our teachers today, we're on target to meet a lot of the stage one.
Mm-hmm.
But once they get the flow of you know working with the curriculum that they have, you usually get one, two, and three for every unit. Do you know what I mean?
I'm not entirely, and I think it's only because of what I'm most familiar with and
sure.
with what's
mm-hmm.
transpiring. So we can
yeah.
have
can,
a sidebar
sure.
on it. And
right, and this is the McTay model for understanding by design, backwards
okay.
design planning.
Okay.
So
thank you, Mr. Allen.
Yeah, not a problem. And this is, we talked about the Common Core 21st Century Skills. You kind of saw a lot of that with the students that were presenting before us. But I think one of the challenging ones is for teachers is to develop ongoing collaboration, having students taking leadership in the classroom. The constant, you know, having the initiative and entrepreneurship, and then developing curiosity and imagination with all these lessons. Here's, and you have this, or it's been sent out anyways, but here are just the updates on all the curriculum work that is going on throughout the year. As we said, this is our mid-year. We're on target for the stage one mapping. As we were saying, some of these other departments in grade levels are, you know, they have one, two, and three for a lot of those units. And the same here for the upperclassmen, the high school, you know, and then district department work. As we started looking at our technology updates, so when we came in or when I was hired in August. Seems so long ago. A lot of the CIT days were already set, and so when Superintendent Benton came on board, her and I talked that we need to kind of get more technology training for the teachers. So at one of our CIT days, we kind of revamped it and we started providing the eighth grade team with some technology training. The other piece too, the second half of the year, we took a group with Principal Peters to Beverly High School, and we spent the morning there where teachers were making connections with some of the Beverly High School teachers with the one-on-one technology program. And they were seeing a lot of, different applications, different online programming, and really seeing a 21st century classroom in a lot of those pieces. So what the goal for that was for the teachers here that are already, some of them are already doing some wonderful things with technology, to kind of start to develop partnerships with other teachers that are, 5 or 6 years ahead of where Wilmington is, and bringing some of those teachers here and then really developing collaboration. From my experience in working with faculty, especially in the upper levels, teachers want to hear from teachers. So it's nice to get an overview of, the device that you're going to use, but an English teacher wants to know how to use it in English class. How are you going to utilize technology? A math teacher wants to know, in the content areas, how is this going to work? And so we started establishing some of those relationships. So we're already working with the Professional Development Committee for next year, and really starting to focus on technology, because, there's going to be two more grades with the Chromebooks next year, and within a short time, we're going to have all of our students with the Chromebooks in a classroom. So we really need to provide our teachers with the up-to-date professional development so they're feeling comfortable with the use of the technology. Switching off to curriculum work at the elementary level and some of the initiatives that are going on there. The Reader's Workshop lesson summary. So this taking a lot of the work that the teachers have already been training and doing and being in the classrooms and doing a lot of the visits. There's a lot of great things going on at the elementary level, and just want to credit the elementary teachers for really doing a wonderful job in rolling this out. And actually, it's been pretty impressive, I think. So really, when you're looking at a Reader's Workshop lesson, there's a mini lesson that's done by the teachers. The anchor charts are the review and the display of the reading strategies. Then the students will go into independent reading, choose just right books. The teacher then confers individually with students or in a small group. And what's really impressive is at the end of the lesson, the group of students come together and then they share out on the different reading strategies they used during the independent reading, looking for accuracy, comprehension, and fluency. And that's just the reading portion of the literacy block. There's also writing that does continue. So, and just seeing it, what's really impressive is from every school, from the Boutwell to the North, to Woburn Street, Shaw Sheen, West, wherever you go, you're seeing the same strategies being implemented. What was really impressive for me is I sat down at the Boutwell with a teacher conferring with a kindergarten student, actually two kindergarten students, and one got stuck on a word and, eventually got to pronounce the word and was asked, what reading strategy, kindergarten, and he explained he used the picture in the book to get the word. So they're talking about like reading strategies when they run into difficulty at the kindergarten level, in the same class. Teacher did a wonderful job. And one of the female students, a child, was having trouble sounding out the word, but found a word within the word. And once she got that word, she could articulate. So we're talking high order thinking skills. These are the some of the things that I'm seeing. So I was really impressed at the kindergarten level. You know, as you move up the chain, you know, to different grades, this conferring, when you listen to the teachers and listening to the students reading and them giving them feedback, they're learning reading strategies. And it's really impressive. You know, I think there are some teachers that are, after 6 months, are very, very comfortable with the reading program. And there are some teachers that are getting more comfortable, you know. But that's a normal process. But when you know an initiative is going well is when the students can tell you what they're doing. And that's the one piece. So when we would ask the students are citing evidence in their books, they're doing two-column notes on how they're going to write, and they can all articulate when you ask, you know, what are you doing today? You know, what reading strategies are you using? So, and that's important. The other piece that we did this year is halfway through the, we did a survey, a mid-year teacher survey, staff survey. And got some great feedback on, you know, what's going well and what areas, you know, do you need help and support. In working with Holly and TLA, we kind of restructured the support, you know, for the support for the second half of the year to give more coaching and support. You know, one area is the conferring on one-to-one and the note-taking. Teachers feel they need a little more support with that. So that's kind of the second half of the year, kind of what we're working on, you know, with the teachers. So we restructured the TLA reading supports for this half from that mid-year survey of trying to help out. Going into next year, we're getting teacher feedback also and looking at a possible piloting instead of the writer's workshop, like throughout the entire district, you know, start to pilot a writer's workshop with a few teachers in every school. So they get comfortable, and it's like train the trainer model, where they're getting support with the writing, where they're getting comfortable, and then their peers within every within each school can you know, learn from one another. And it's a smaller scale with success in every school. So that's kind of what we're talking about now from the teacher survey. The other piece is going into next year, K in grade 2 will be implemented in Reader's Workshop. Grades 1, 3, 4, and 5 will continue to refine the skills and strategies. And then we're looking, as we said, the possible writing labs to develop a train-the-trainer model and working with teachers to identify that. I'm going to be curious to see. I mean, I know that in the MCAS, because of the you know, it's a new test, and it's all online, pretty much. So those scores are embargoed. But I'm going to be curious to see, because one of the, you know, Wilmington's no different from any other district. One of the toughest parts of the ELA portion is evidence-based, you know, informational text. Mm-hmm. Taking evidence from what you read to defend your, you know, opinion or argument. And throughout this first half of the year, our students in a lot of the different schools are developing finding evidence, you know, with post-its, with note-taking. So I'm thinking, you know, I'm probably jumping the gun here, but I'm thinking because it's been such a focus with the Reader's Workshop in grades 1, 3, 4, and 5, that they're already going through their reading and finding evidence base to support, you know, different aspects of their writing. I think that, you know, they're going to be used to that. So we'll see. So that's kind of like where we're at with the Reader's Workshop. We're going to continue to monitor the faculty and send out more surveys, but it's, change is different. You know, I've been through it as a former principal, and when you're going from something you've always done to implement, it's difficult, but that's why you get faculty input, and there are some things that we can change as we move forward, and that's what we'll do. Elementary STEM, curriculum team. So we're looking at the DSE, the curriculum unit design. They've done a lot of work on that, implementing one unit next year for each grade level. And then working with Reader's Workshop, and we talk about informational text reading. We're looking to tie in some of those units and some of those science units into the Reader's Workshop model too. So we're talking about that. So when a student has to go and choose just the right book, there'll be a science book that they can read also. The other really important piece is the maker spaces. You know, Heather Peachy and other curriculum team development in the libraries, maker spaces, tying in a lot of the science piece and engineering. And then always the STEM fair, which is a big hit in Wilmington, and that's ongoing.
Mr. Gilman?
Yes.
What's a makerspace?
Makerspace is where you're taking the creativity of science. So, for example, the students will plan. I'm trying to explain it. So.
Is it like an innovative, creative area where they come together,
correct.
Like
so
a think tank?
So they develop a plan, then they create, you know.
Right.
So it can be all the way from developing, robotics, Legos,
mm-hmm.
Building, to the point where a makerspace, they work in to develop a blueprint and then use different items.
So from concept to completion, so to speak. Yes?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. So that's all part of the hands-on project-based learning aspect at the elementary level.
Thank you.
Yeah. All right. So science and math updates at the middle school and elementary. Just touch base on the Envisions math. It's the second year at the elementary level. The teachers are, you know, once again doing well, focused on the differentiated instruction aspect of that. Problem solving, utilizing some of the online supports with the Envisions math. As we move up to the middle school level, they started the implementation of the math pilot there. They're also utilizing and revising the science series at the middle school level. And so I think that's one of the successes, the Envisions math program last year, so year two, and now they're utilizing the online, as we said, the online aspects of that program. The middle school math has been working with the program throughout the year, along with our science teachers. All right, next, social-emotional learning. So there's been a lot of work, I think, done around this throughout the year. We really focused on being at the middle school. I think it was a blessing when I had to go over there for November and December. I got to learn and work with a lot of great faculty members, students, and a lot of wonderful people. But we started looking at a research-based bullying and cyberbullying curriculum. The Massachusetts Aggression Reduction Center is one that a lot of the districts are starting to utilize now. So it's an evidence-based bullying program. The curriculum's divided into 20-minute lessons, segments. The intention is to utilize the curriculum, which would be either like in a homeroom or an advisory down the line. Right now, we're utilizing it in the wellness and physical education classes. This is a new program that we brought into the middle school and the high school, and it's also part of our coordinated review in the bullying laws that all districts need to have a research-based bullying program. The elementary levels already have their program, so we focused on the upper levels. You know, they have the second step. So Wilmington Middle School, these are some of the culture presentations that we developed. I get all my notes here, but I'm just gonna talk through it. So the Wilmington PAC really was instrumental in getting this Ed Garrity to speak. Ed Garrity spoke for each grade level for about 50 minutes, and in addition, in the afternoon, he worked with 80 student leaders. And the topics are there, what he focused on with the students. In the student leader group, right after this assembly, they started to put together a school-wide dream board project and then kindness post-its project. Kindness Club has been developed at the middle school. This is co-led by students, administration, and parent volunteer. I think this is very important. You know, I always felt the first place when you're looking at culture is you start with the students, and students respond. When you give students an opportunity to take some ownership of their school, take some responsibility, great things happen. And this is what's happening at the middle school. And, you know, Principal Walsh has really also helped out with continuing a lot of the great things. In addition, we brought in 7th and 8th grade cyber safety, cyberbullying through the Middlesex Partnership for Youth. And this was navigating the digital world for the students. And that was presented to 7th and 8th grade students, which ties in to some of the positive culture support that we were doing. We also reached out, tied in a lot of to the community and the parents. We did the Alice Brown Legrand has been, you know, great addition this year, and she's the fall and winter mental health first aid courses offered for staff and parents. Fall anxiety workshop for parents offered by CPAC. And as you know, can see, Middlesex Partner, they did a parent one that followed up the student digital, navigating digital world. And then we just had the behavior health fair. We did Finding Balance for our students. That was a keynote with Jen Fuellen, Executive Functioning. And then there was 10 breakout sessions that parents could attend after that. And Wilmington Police and the Wilmington Substance Abuse Coalition were instrumental in working with a lot of, you know, the students. So this was, you know, some of the things that we've done up to this point for the parents. We did, Alice and myself presented PBIS to everybody, I think a couple months ago. That's just kind of, you know, where we're at with that PBIS implementation at Shawshene Bowell Middle School in Woburn Street. And there's initial teams being developed at the Wildwood North and West. And I told Steve, the last school committee, I broke a board, so that's me breaking a board. I had to fit that in somewhere, so I put it on.
Those pictures can be doctored.
Yeah. I had a, you know, I was out 3 days. I pulled a muscle in my back. That was after I watched a six-year-old break the board first. So I figured, this is wonderful. We're gonna, you know, we'll do the audit. We'll do the program review. So, and I provided information. I'm not gonna. This is a quick summary of a lot of the great work. But of all the audits, this will be my third, you know, the first in Wilmington, but I had two I was part of in my previous district. It's a lot of work. Mm-hmm. Really, you know, you just want to make sure you're in compliance with, from start to finish, with policies, procedures for special education, and then all of your civil rights documents. So there's, and I provided you all just like the little subtitles of all the documents that we're collecting, you know, throughout this year that we're uploading and submitting. But I wanted to, you know, thank Amanda Cox at Central Office. She's been great at collecting all of our civil rights data and information, and Patty McGee and Kathy Fuller, and for all their work down at the special ed office, and also Jen Mahan and Alice Brown LeGrand for all of their work. So we've collected the documents over the past 2 months, and we're going to go through them. We're going to upload them. And then the process is, once the state has them, we'll have a liaison that will kind of go through some of the documents. And there may be some things that we might need to tweak and fix between now and when they come in. And they'll be here in the fall, and they usually spend about, I want to say about a week. And they'll interview, they'll go to all the schools, they'll interview teachers, ed assistants, administrators, school committee, parents, and they go through everything. It's a lot of work, but I think it's a necessity just to make sure that we're in compliance and supporting all of our students. So that's my 20-minute summary of everything that's kind of going on in the district.
Can I ask you a quick question?
Surely.
I know that with special education, there's a halfway point at the three-year mark for these reviews, and then a six-year complete overhaul.
Yes.
Is that where we're entering?
We're in the sixth complete
year.
Okay,
gotcha.
Overall.
Okay.
Yep.
Thank you.
Yes.
I was just going to ask, I heard you say that the school committee gets to be interviewed or is part of the review.
Mm-hmm.
What can we do as a committee to help support the district's efforts in not just this, but some of the other items that you mentioned?
Yeah, I think what the initial uploading of the, you know, of all of our documents and evidence, and then, you know, we'll be working with the liaison, but mm-hmm. there may be some things on policies and procedures that we may have to, you know, tweak, or, and if that's the case, you know, if it's our bullying policy or if it's something, then that would be presented, I think, to you as a, you know, a revision, and then you would all approve it. So it's like an ongoing, you know, process.
Right.
But there may be some things that if we have to revise some of our policies that you'll have to approve as a board. So we may be bringing some of those to you.
Okay, great. Thank
but
you.
But I think we're in pretty good shape,
great,
you know.
Thank you. Any other questions or comments from Mr. Gallagher?
I just want to say thank you for the presentation this evening and bringing us up to speed with how things are happening throughout the district.
That was Paul's challenge. He says, I want you to tell us everything that's going on in the district, but you have 15 minutes to do it.
No, this is great. Thank you very
much.
Thank you very much for that presentation. Okay, public comments. Crickets. All right. That's not a bad thing. Subcommittee reports. No? Okay. I'm just going to make note that at our next meeting in April 26th, we'll do our annual reorg, and we'll revisit who wants to participate on which subcommittee report, which subcommittees. So they are attached in our packet if you want to take a look and see what you might like to be involved with for the next school year. Come prepared with that. All right, correspondence. We do have one letter we need to read. Your last official duties.
Oh, okay. All right, so this is, Dear School Committee, as you stated in your message to the staff, the heart of our system is the relationship between the children and their teachers. The Wilmington Teachers Association completely agrees and exemplifies this belief with each decision it makes. We understand that the Wilmington School Committee is tasked with the important job of selecting a new superintendent. The role of the superintendent is integral to the culture of the school system. This culture dictates how teachers form relationships with their students. The WTA, like you, shares the common interest of moving the district forward and welcoming a new leader. We feel that while the school committee is entrusted with the decision, it should be made with input from the educators. Like you, we will be working with the new superintendent to meet current goals, and we'll be working to create new goals for the district. We understand that this is an important decision, especially after the turbulent year Wilmington Public Schools has had. We respect that this decision must be made by the school committee, but we implore that you consider the input of the people that work with the students of Wilmington to create the heart of the Wilmington Public Schools. Thank you, Robert Moriello, president of the Wilmington Teachers Association.
Great. Thank you, Mrs. Bonish. As I mentioned earlier in our meeting this evening, due to some of the transitions we've had, we are pressing pause on any further search activity so we can have an opportunity to catch our breath. Also, the timing of the year is not the best match for resuming search activities. So I would just encourage the community, stay with us, have patience with us. We will keep you updated. I appreciate the input that the WTA wishes to have, and we certainly appreciate and respect what they have to say, but stay tuned. Okay, great. Just some future meeting dates to be aware of. Our next meeting in April is April 26th, and we'll have at least one new member of our committee. Also, I want to put a plug in for the STEM Fair, as Mr. Gallagher referred to, on Thursday, April 27th, starting at 6 o'clock to 8 o'clock, I believe it is, at the middle school. CAF is the annual STEM Fair, and this is a great event, truly enjoyed by the families in Wilmington. So if you have the opportunity to stop by, feel free. And I have just as much fun as my kid does every year. So that is great. And I think with that, we can ask for a motion to adjourn. So Mr. Mulis.
Can I just say something?
Yes, absolutely.
I just want to say thank you to everybody. And I really had a rewarding experience on the committee. And I'm really going to miss everybody. I'm going to miss being involved with this is an interest of mine, and I hope to stay connected with all of you and with the schools, and so thank you.
Thank you. We appreciate you. It.
And thank you for the flowers, Emma.
You're welcome. So we had a second. All those in favor of the join? Thank you very much.